On the Medical Watch, the potential to link the human brain with a computer is a step closer to reality, according to Elon Musk, who says his company implanted the Neuralink brain chip into a patient. Other companies are exploring similar devices, which could transform lives for those with motor function issues. How far has science come in helping people function better, and how far off is this technology from becoming an option for people in need? Dr. Chirstopher Ahuja, neurosurgeon at Northwestern Medicine, joins us now to put this all in perspective. Thank you so much, doctor.
Thank you for having me.
So tell us more about how this idea works, this brain-machine interface.
Absolutely. So what they've done is they've essentially implanted a small chip with a battery inside it with what they call threads or small wires that allow electrodes to go deep inside the brain into an area that's responsible for movement.
So now simply by thinking about moving or thinking about speaking, the device will then interpret that brain activity?
That's the eventual goal of this. The first stage is that they have the device interpret that activity and allow patients to be able to move a cursor on a screen, for example, or control a phone. Downstream, the long-term vision is that it'll be allowed to have patients restore some of their movement functions.
I imagine there are so many people out there right now who are thinking this could be really exciting. Who would be the best candidates to benefit the most? It seems like it could really have wide-reaching impact.
Absolutely. So the patients that we see, unfortunately, that have these devastating illnesses like spinal cord injury or ALS are probably the ones that will benefit the most. That is the initial patient population that this trial is trying to target, called the PRIME study from Neuralink. And downstream from that, it may be individuals with stroke or other debilitating illnesses as well.
So when you hear this, currently what are your options as a surgeon for these types of patients, and how exciting does this seem from your perspective?
Right now, when someone comes to us with a terrible brain or spinal cord injury, essentially once they've completed their course of rehabilitation, the amount of function that they're left with is often what they're left with for life. And so then it becomes about coping with whatever deficits they may have and being able to function with the best possible quality of life. So when we see efforts like this being made, it gets us excited. This is not the first time this is being done. This has been done in other studies and by other companies, even as recently as a few years ago. There's some large announcements from Australia. But it gets us excited that efforts and spotlight are being put on this very important field.
And I'm sure with the excitement, you have to think about the potential risks as we go down this road.
Absolutely. So anytime we perform an operation on the brain, whether it be a new therapy like this or something that we've done many times before, there's inherent risks of surgery, whether that be bleeding or infection or injury to critical structures of the brain. And obviously those risks are very important. We take those very seriously. And so that's important when we talk about these types of experimental therapies, is that these risks exist. They need to be balanced against the potential benefit.
And when we think about this chip in a person's brain, it sounds very science fiction. What about the possibility of hacking the computer?
Yeah, these are issues that have come up even in the past. We've had implanted devices in people's brains for many decades now. Deep brain stimulators are quite a successful therapy for many disorders, including Parkinson's disease or tremors. It's an implanted device with a battery that can actually respond to the outside world and be interrogated. And so that cybersecurity threat, if you will, exists even there, and there are measures to safeguard against that.
All right, very quickly, when do you think patients might really be able to use this technology?
It takes time. We have to crawl before we walk, before we run. It's exciting to see every time a new piece of technology comes that may push that envelope a little bit further. But it takes a long time. Once that spark happens and somebody unlocks the right key, the floodgates will open. So we remain optimistic, but it takes these types of efforts and steps to really figure that out.
All right. Well, let's leave our viewers with that optimism. Dr. Chirstopher Ahuja, thank you so much.
Thank you.